I should probably say something, but I will. Not right now.
Thank you.
Kind of nice when all that modulation just stops for a while, isn't it? Hang on, Sloopy, yeah, Sloopy, hang on. I wrote this next song while smoking a cigar, and that may explain some of the point of view in this thing, but I was dry. What I should say is that this is not pessimism. I've learned that some people think it is. I can't understand why, really, especially by the time you've gotten to the end of it, if you're still with me by then. As a matter of fact, I was driving through New Mexico on the way from one job to another one, and I heard this on the radio. So I pulled off, to the side of the road. And doesn't happen very often, and I like to give it my full attention when it does. And I listened to it, and when it was finished, the disc jockey came on and said, a lot of people don't like that song. This was a station in Santa Fe. And I thought, well, you can imagine what I thought. But then he said, it's the most requested tune off of my new album, and that they love to play my new album, blah, 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 so I felt better after that. But then, I think to compensate for what he thought were these complaints about the dark mood of this piece, he played something called Keep On Keeping On, which was so optimistic that I wanted to cut my throat. I don't know about anybody else who heard it. Thank you. every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed, and you crawl out of bed, and you crawl out of bed. Every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. And you look out the moon where the window is, and the stars shine, and the stars shine, and the stars shine. Every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. Down below in the sun belt and the telephones and the telephones and the telephones, you look out the moon where the window is every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. And some of us breathe in the brown ground where the worms clown, where the worms clown, where the worms clown. Way down below in the sun belt every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. Every night when you lay down, you fall flat, you fall flat, you fall flat. Some of us breathe in the brown ground every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. So we're all asleep in the same dream, in the snort fort, in the snort fort, in the snort fort. Every night when you lay down, every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. Santa Claus modified snow peas on the sunroofs, on the sunroofs, on the sunroofs, and we're all asleep in the same dream every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. If you look in the mirror, it's your father's face and the thin grin and the thin grin and the thin grin. Santa Claus pulling up snow peas every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. There's tears in the bank and a credit card in the backyard, in the backyard, in the backyard. If you look in the mirror, it's your father's face every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. And once in a while when the wind blows and the heart whines and the heart whines and the heart whines, there's tears in the bank and a credit card every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. There's lint in the pocket or a breath mint or a car key or a car key or a car key. Once in a while when the wind blows, every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. And your kid has a face like a walnut from the ice cream, from the ice cream, from the ice cream. And there's lint in the pocket and a breath mint every day in the morning when you get up. Every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out. Every day in the morning when you get up and you crawl out of bed. This is a guitar that I think in January will. There. It's a longer neck, you see. It will be available to what's called the general public, as opposed to the specific, I guess, public. It'll have my name on it on the 12th fret. I've had something to say about how this thing has been built. For example, I told them to change the shape of the cutaway, and they did. And what I haven't told them is that I really regret that. Thank you. I'm always finding things I want to fiddle with when I'm up here. And I know I can't just sit down and play this for half an hour. And I also know when I get off during the break and try and remember what this is, I'll have completely forgotten. So let me just get a little bit more here. It isn't all that hot, though, really, is it? Well, that's okay. This is called "I Yell at Traffic." Thank you. This is a, I think I'm in tune. This is a song that I like to think that I wrote for a friend of mine named Buell, who was see, what he was at one time was a cello player, and now he's a bass player, and I guess I was caught up short by having to make a choice between the two. He doesn't really play much cello anymore, and debuted when he was 14. He's about 830 years old now. He's been around a long time, and developed all these great ideas and this really extraordinary technique. He's a remarkable musician, but he was evidently just as remarkable when he was 14 as he is now when he's 800 and whatever it is. And he was a big hit with the New York Philharmonic playing the Dvorak Cello Concerto. And his instrument was on loan from a museum, which I guess is customary for people of his talent. And when he got back home to Long Island, the cello began to speak to him, and he destroyed it on the back of a chair, having spent, I guess, a lifetime before he was even conscious of having one, chained to this thing, museum piece or not. And he claims that he got more than a little shook, and I don't doubt it, when the cello, after he destroyed it on the chair, continued to speak to him from the parts on the floor around his feet. And I like to think that this is what the cello would be saying to him today, and it probably is saying something to him today. Should live in Dave's hands at Sunnyland Bar and count their little days there turning into dark. Won't you tell me how I can see you now? Tell me why everybody tries, everybody lies. I was first heard this next song playing with a job with a man named Turley Richards in Detroit at a club called the Poison Apple, which eventually burned down. And we were playing there at a time when the whole city was about to burn down and nobody was coming out to, you know, see a couple people play. And Turley was new to me. He was the first person I, well, I've never known how to put this, but Turley was blind, and he'd been blind twice in his life, and he had developed an attitude that was, as you might imagine, was astonishing. And he had a voice that I've never forgotten. I haven't heard him since, though, and it's too bad. He was a really remarkable singer, but maybe the reason he hasn't been heard from since is that whoever dressed Turley really had it in for him, because, and how I considered, you know, I considered taking Turley aside, and saying, you do look like a clown, Turley, but what good would that do him, you know? So I didn't say anything. And I'm not really sure why I'm bringing it up now, because maybe it'll get back to him somewhere. But I also, you know, had to pause, because I've never been that sure of how I look myself, and I'm responsible for this. These shoes, for example, are not really meant only for orderlies. I have about half of an ankle left on my right leg. I'm glad it's on my leg and not somewhere else from using it wrong about 2 weeks ago, which is all beside the point. I'm trying to point out that after a week at the Poison Apple, we were really depressed, Turley and I. There was nobody, literally nobody had come. Well, not literally. There'd been maybe one or two people per night, and we played three sets a night. So it really didn't matter that much what Turley looked like or what I was doing or anything. And, you know, the owner was standing back in the shadows and making little internal noises, and so it was terrible. And not only that, but we had to stay there. They had a part of the deal was you could live upstairs, and that sounded good before we got there, before we were upstairs. And then we also had to share the quarters that were up there, Turley and I. And I got, what I learned from that was that I leave trails everywhere, just floating in the air. And they all have a smell, and I found that to be intimidating, I guess. Turley could tell me everything that I'd done the night before and what I was doing that morning, what I'd had for dinner, what I was... I don't know if I should continue with some of this, but I didn't say this, someone else did, so I might as well quote him. I played Nashville Now with Doc Watson, and during Doc's part of the interview, Ralph Emery asked him if he'd learned how to play by ear. Just baffles you, you know, it did me. Anyhow, so the week had gone by, I was, you know, walking on eggs, bathing as much as I could without removing all of my skin and so, you know, so on and so forth. We're just hoping the week would end, and so was Turley, and then a guy showed up named Mick Clark and sang this song for us. He was the next act to play this place. They said that Louise was not half bad. It was written on the walls and window shades. And though she'd act a little girl,
But a deceiver, don't believe her, that's her trade. Sometimes a bottle of perfume, flowers, and maybe some lace. Men brought Louise 10-cent trinkets. Their intentions were easily traced. And everybody knew at times she cried. Oh, but women like Louise, they get by.
When Mick was done with that tune, Turley and I said, "This is just the place for you, Mick." This is a song that I've written for the story of Paul Bunyan. It's a part of this children's series that Rabbit Ears Productions is doing. This one is narrated by Jonathan Winters, and they've asked me to sing some of the stuff. I'm not going to do that here, because I can only sing about lumberjacks if I'm all alone, you know, facing the wall somewhere. This one is, actually, I'm not really sure where this one goes yet, but reasons I'm playing it now, so I can find out. I played up in St. Cloud a couple weeks ago, more or less, and I remembered that one of the first things that ever occurred to me when I was on stage anywhere, and it was here in Minneapolis at the old Scholar down at Seven Corners, and or actually, I guess, it was the second Scholar in Seven Corners, and I had a gooseneck microphone, and or two of them, and I'd get the mic more or less placed, and then the gooseneck would sort of straighten out like that, and I'd grab it, and I was wrenching this thing, and I don't think I had spoken to anybody in an audience since I began playing, but I felt, matter of fact, I couldn't look up, and as I've said before, that caused me a lot of problems. I drooled on my 12th fret there at the Scholar one night because I had my eyes closed and my mouth open, and you know, I was in oblivion somewhere. And it's hard to be brought back to reality by your own effluent, you know. There you are in front of, well, must have been all, you know, maybe 23 people. But they were, you know, real closer than they wanted to be to this action. I was fiddling with this gooseneck, and I said, and I asked these 23 people if anybody in the crowd had ever killed a chicken, and then it had just sort of glanced across what passed for my mind at that time back then, that I had killed a chicken, and it all flooded in on me, and I and I told them all about it. And I'm gonna, and I did it in St. Cloud, and I'm gonna do it here because I did it for, actually, I enjoyed it so much that I did it again and again for years, and I did it so much that I got sick of it and tried to forget it. And I haven't mentioned it for years, but it's unforgettable to me. It may not be good news for anybody else, but as I learned, not just then, excuse me, I don't mean to blind you. This was a really important moment in my life, this chicken, because I was at the time planning to spend my life as a trombone player. And that doesn't even make me laugh anymore when I think about it. But I was serious. I was really serious about this. And spent a lot of time trying to develop tone on my trombone and visiting guys sort of 45 years old or more, sitting in their basements with their trombones who would wait for kids like me to come in so they could pick on them and tell them, you know, what flabby lips they had and what a terrible embouchure that you had there and where's your tone. And but despite that, I hadn't realized that the trombone was not for me, and I was really pursuing it more or less with a vengeance, as, you know, as vengeful as you can be when you're I quit when I was about 12, so there wasn't a lot of heat in this pursuit, but there was a lot of good intentions, and I played in I wanted to play the by the way, maybe I should mention there'll be a break right after this. My ankle is spreading up now to my knee. I wanted to play the flute. At the time, I wanted to play the flute. We lived in Wyoming. Is this as important to you as it is to me? I know the answer to that. Here was another one of these guys. In this case, not the men who sit in basements with trombones and clarinets and stuff and get paid for that. Here was a guy who drove around the state of Wyoming with a truck full of instruments. There were these nickel things, not brass, but the nickel ones that you see behind Abraham Lincoln when he's addressing the troops. If you've ever wondered where they go into the mouths of little children, at least in Wyoming. And this guy would bring them into a basement room in Pioneer School and sit back there where the bricks are sweating and the boiler is turning to rust and getting ready to burst. And lure children in there to put their lips on these things that are, you know, older than the boiler that you're standing next to, and covered with that green sort of accretion of whatever that is so prominent on the outside that you can't help but wonder how prominent it is on the inside. And the idea was if you could ask for any of the instruments on the table, if anything that was left, after the big rush to go, you know, see these things, and if you could make a sound on it, you could take it home with you for a year. So I went down there with the rest of the rush, which is about two other fools, and we walked in, and I told him I wanted to play a flute, and he handed me a trombone with some comment again about my mouth and that it was too big for a flute, and I did try the flute, producing the sonic equivalent of foam on the flute, and just proving him right. So off I went. It took me 9 years, I think, to get the joke. At least by the time I realized it wasn't for me, it took this event with a chicken to convince me. Whew. I should have maybe gotten through that in the beginning of the set and then waited a half an hour to get to the rest of this. Maybe I will. Anyhow. But I'm not. I'm committed now. So I wound up going through all of these prescribed routes that exist for people that have been snared into the system. The brass system or the woodwind system, and I was in a band by this time in Oklahoma, a marching band called the West Junior High School Marching Band, and I sat directly across from the woodwind section. I had excelled, at least in Muskogee, Oklahoma, I had excelled on the trombone to the point that I was first chair. And that put me in a direct line of sight with the woodwind section. And now there are instruments that are in bands, in high school and junior high school bands, only for purposes of punishment. They aren't there for their musical qualities, or at least for the qualities that some kid can get out of them. If you're a real, you know, a jerk and you make nothing but trouble, the primary tool, at least in our band, of you know, retribution was the tuba. And if you made too much trouble, your instrument would be taken away from you and you'd be forced to play the tuba. Which really is a pretty diabolical punishment, but on the other hand, it's also kind of like giving a gun to a lunatic in this case. You can do things with a tuba that you can't even touch with a trumpet or the tuba, the euphonium, which is a thing that looks like a baby with a big mouth. And in this case, directly across from me, the E flat clarinet, which is a thing about so long, it had a bore the size of a pencil, a reed like a rock. And so it was like playing this was like trying to force air through a screwdriver. You couldn't get anything from it. And the guy whose clarinet had been taken away from him and who had been handed the E-flat clarinet, mainly for just plain turpitude, musical turpitude, was a guy named Roger, who was an albino guy who, I have to add, was called White Hair by the band because, I mean, I only mention that because I want to indicate the muted sensibility for metaphor that exists in the junior high school bands. I don't know why I did that. So I got to watch Roger blow the back of his head off every day of his life that we were playing in this thing. And I think because of that, he determined that we'd developed a relationship. You know, we'd never said a word to each other, but and he approached me one day and he said, "Why don't you come out to the farm?" And I won't go into that, but I didn't want to do that. But I did, for reasons I won't bother to go into. I just, you know, we can accept that I was a trombonist. So I went out to the farm, and what I had feared about this place came true instantly. I knew the moment we drove into this place that I was doomed, that the only thing you did on a farm to have it for fun was work, and you worked from sun up to sundown, and you did it all weekend, and then, you know, and the old hands would laugh at the city slicker, or so I thought. There weren't any hands. I was the hand, and we spent at least a whole day dragging hay bales behind a pickup truck that disintegrated, and that was a lot of fun. And then the cows came out from nowhere in this gray oblivion and ate what had shattered upon the ground. And we drove up to a 10-foot, I don't know how tall this thing was. It looked huge to me. Pile of stuff that I have not yet identified. I don't think I really want to know. But it was green and it was huge, and everything being compressed at the bottom of this pile tended to ooze out this green sort of halo around it on the ground. So we climbed up to the top of that and sat up there and, you know, looked around. And it just got worse and worse. We got back to the farm. Roger was having fun. I wasn't having any fun. And he, I think, decided to have even more fun rather than what I thought was an offer to entertain me. He determined to really have a good time. And because we got into the farmyard or the barn, or the back of the house back behind the farm, and he said, "How'd you like to kill a chicken?" And we were standing conveniently by a chicken coop. And I said, "Sure." Every time, this is what part of what gets me about this. These chickens had seen Roger or somebody come into their midst day in and day out and kill one of them. But there they were, just jillions of chickens looking up and, you know, brainless little. And I assumed that we'd, you know, grab one of these things, chop its head off, watch what was left, run around, and then fall over in the dust and kick and, you know, that. So I was ready for that. But Roger said, "I'll show you how." And he reached down and he selected one of these volunteers down here at his feet, grabbed it by his head, its head, and said, "Some people don't like this part of this." And then he gave it a little at the end, and at the end of the chicken, I thought, boy, oh boy. So I selected my applicant down here. There it is now. This one is hanging there, and they're still down here. Step on me. Do whatever you want to do. Me, please. Kill me. So I picked up a chicken, and I did this, and I gave it a little twink. Nothing happened. And I thought, well, I wasn't, you know, I had assumed there was nothing to this, really, and hadn't really put my heart into it. So I did it again, and nothing happened, and I did it again and again. There is an art to at least, that's what an axe is for, I guess, because I couldn't do a thing. The bird was getting furious, and I was embarrassed. And Roger said, "Well, why don't you let go of its head, take hold of its feet, and beat it up against the side of the chicken coop?" If you swing something at a fender of a car or a cat, like, or a, it's not, even a chicken will not leave its head out there for you to bonk it on a wall. Something, you know, some glimmer of something lights up in them, and they just turn their head on the way by. And what you have left is a body about the size of half of my fist in a pile of feathers that big, so that you can be there for the rest of the day pounding on this wall. And I was. It was like those dreams where your feet are stuck and you're running and you can't move, and the chicken was doing nothing. Roger said, "Well, why don't you hold it down, and I'll back the tractor over its head over here." This is the truth. Well, a tread on a tractor tire is like years between, and all we succeeded in doing was pinning it there in the dirt. I was pretty humiliated. I can't speak for the chicken, but I imagine it was even further upset. Came back, and it, probably half an hour, we left it there. When we came back, it had died of boredom in the dark down beneath the tire. It was dead. And somehow that's why I quit playing the trombone. I'll be back in a little while. Thank you. See you in a few minutes. Thank you. Do one more in that sort of place. That was written by Carla Bley, and that arrangement is by Tim Sparks. It plays all over town. This is a song that I wrote a few years after hearing a story from a woman named Seka Tavchar in Ljubljana, Yugoslavia. I was on a tour with Paco de Lucia, and I met her and a mountain climber and an architect and a couple other people who had been brought out sort of to the shows that we were doing there, and learned that her father had designed most of the bridges in Ljubljana. And when she was around 4 or 5 years old, had been arrested and taken off somewhere. They were never told where, or even exactly what happened to him or what was going to happen to him. 20 years later, he was released, because he was sick, and he came home. And they learned that he'd been imprisoned across the street from them in a basement cell, and he could look up from his window and see she and her sister playing on their balcony. And he watched them grow up from down there. Thank you.
been, where you been. Now and then I think about you and me. No use fighting about things we can't recall, 'cause it don't matter now at all. Just come on in, baby, we'll laugh and sing, and we'll make love, let the telephone ring. Ring, ring, doorbell ring, come on in, I got Mel Blanc on the radio. I'm glad you came around, I've been feeling down, talking to Tony and Mario. You know they make good conversation, still it ain't no consolation. 'Cause I got love, baby, I'll give you some, and if somebody comes, let the doorbell ring.
You still want to know where I got these stands? Somebody wanted to know down here. How many people here saw Astor Piazzolla when he played over at Northrop, what was it, a few months ago? Yeah, well, good. Jeez, it's odd. You know, I would have thought this was full over there, more or less. And, well. But for those of you who aren't familiar with him, he plays a form of tango that's largely his own doing. It's really wonderful stuff, but it's kind of radical by conservative standards. And, he walked around New York a few years ago and had played a couple concerts. Somebody walked up to him and said, "Hello, are you Astor Piazzolla?" He said, "Yes," expecting, you know, to, you know, he thought, "Well, yeah, of course I am. I suppose it's a..." He was probably thrilled, and the guy punched him in the nose, knocked him down, and said, "That's for what you did to the tango." I'm the guy who didn't marry pretty Pamela Brown, educated, well-intentioned, good girl in our town. I wonder where I'd be today if she had loved me too. Probably be driving kids to school. I guess I owe it all to Pamela Brown. All of my good times, all my running around. One of these days I might be in your town. I guess I owe it all to Pamela Brown. Seen the lights of cities and I've been inside their doors. Sailed to foreign countries and walked upon their shores. I guess the guy she married was the best part of my life. She dug him 'cause he drove a pickup truck. I guess I owe it all to Pamela Brown. All of my good times, all my running around. One of these days I might be in your town. And I guess I owe it all to Pamela Brown. Tell you just how beautiful she was. Everything it takes to get a guy like me in love. Lord, I hope she's happy 'cause she sure deserves to be, especially for what she did for me. I guess I owe it all to Pamela Brown. All of my good times, all my running around. One of these days I might be in your town, and I guess I owe it all to Pamela Brown. Guess I owe it all to Pamela Brown. Thank you. Now, it's always interesting to find out who listens to the music that you do, as Astor Piazzolla found out. And I was playing in Tucson a couple of years ago. I was outdoors in the middle of the night, and it was a beautiful night. The stars were out. It was kind of cool, and there was grass everywhere, which is, you know, this was, you know, well-tended grass. And a big hill, and it was kind of a breeze, and I was having a wonderful time. And a guy crossed my mind who I hadn't thought of in quite a while, thankfully so. He was known in Tucson for the murders that he committed there. He was his name was Charles Schmidt, and there have been plays written about this guy since then, but only to, you know, indicate that he holds other people's attention, not just mine. I want to really emphasize that. And I read about him, first read about him at a time in my life when I had to, well, it doesn't matter about that, actually. It disturbed me when I found out about this guy in ways that actually still disturb me. And there isn't anything about him that isn't disturbing, so I guess that doesn't disturb me that I'm disturbed, but it does bother me that, like this chicken, he's occupied this much time tonight, for example. But he was, maybe the most remarkable thing about this guy was that people would, he would drive up and down Speedway Boulevard, and people would get in the car with him. Sort of like these chickens that are down at your feet, that just, this guy sent out clues like nobody's business that, you know, he was not somebody to go have a beer with. He didn't, well, you may have already realized yourselves or deduced that he had a very low self-esteem, and he tried to compensate for what he thought of himself by, among other things, putting beer cans and flattening them out and putting them in the bottoms of his boots to add some height to his allure. And he wore a beauty mark of motor oil on his right cheek. And as he drove up and down Speedway Boulevard, he'd turn the rearview mirror so that it would reflect his own face and this mobile beauty mark that, you know, would slowly collect in his lap by the end of the night. And he'd pull up this, well, people would say, sure, I'll go anywhere with you. And off they went, and I never heard from him again. He was called the Pied Piper of Tucson, which was somebody's muted metaphor there in Tucson. And for some reason, I asked this crowd in the middle of a wonderful night if anybody here had heard of Charles Schmidt. And I expected kind of a municipal groan, and then, you know, I'd have to recover from whatever damage I'd done. And nothing happened. Nobody did know him, but way back on the top of the hill, a woman said, "Yay!" So, you know, I went on to the next tune and dropped that whole issue. I was done with the night. I went off to the side of the stage, and she turned up, and she said, "I was the one who said yay." You know, and I... she said, "I'm an English teacher, and my professor taught English in the prison that they sent Charles Schmidt to. And Charles Schmidt joined his poetry class, changed his name, and became a poet." Oh, you know, I wondered where this was going, and she added that Charles Schmidt had died in prison, that he'd been stabbed to death with a can opener. First experience with literary criticism, I suppose. But among other things about this guy, that can opener occupies my mind at times. It's like being murdered with a swizzle stick or something. It must have taken weeks and weeks and weeks. You know. Whose turn is it to perforate Charles tonight? And she said, "I have all of his poems." Would you like to see them? I said, sure. And I left. And sure enough, a few weeks later, I got back home. I was scrounging around in the mailbox, and there's a big manila envelope. And here were a bunch of Xerox copies of these poems. She kept the originals. And I couldn't resist reading them. Who could? Well, maybe all of you could. I couldn't resist reading them. And they were exactly what you'd expect them to be. Just right down to, absolutely, perfectly Charles Schmidt-ian. And so I got to the lad, I read every word. And I got to the last page and the last poem, and down at the bottom of the page, she had appended a note for me, and it said, Dear Leo, I hope these poems mean as much to you as your music has meant to me. So I would like to thank you for coming tonight. This is one of my favorite nights in the year. Good night. See you next year, I hope. Thanks a lot. Thank you. Say what? Oh. This is a song called William Powell. My producer and old friend, T-Bone Burnett, was out nightclubbing, and he saw Lana Turner was in the same nightclub, and there was a band there that had advertised that it was live, and it wasn't. It was just collected in a pool down there, and she, everybody else was, you know, that's the way that goes, but she was... having none of it, and she harangued these guys and terrified them into the best set of their lives, and everybody had a great time, and she just, you know, led the line all around the room. I wish I'd been there. I wasn't there. And yeah, maybe that's why it's called William Powell. Internal adjustment. Excuse me. Good. Thank you.
Thank you very much.